Would you turn with me, please, to number 281 in your hymnal? 281. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Would you stand with me as we sing? 281 together. Jesus saves. On that first,
we have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the seas and cross the waves. Onward is our Lord's command. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Waft it on the rolling tide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing ye islands of the sea. Echo back the ocean caves. Earth shall keep her to folly. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
On that last,
give the wind a mighty voice.
How many of you, that's the best news you ever heard? Amen. Jesus saves. If you don't know what that means, I hope you'll understand what that means before you go home today. And you can leave knowing that Jesus saves. And that's the good news of the day. And glad we're in church today. Good to see each one of you here. Let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for the wonderful news. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Thank you, Father, for a great salvation that you provided through your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we want to bow before you here at the beginning of our service, tell you that we love you. We're thankful for all you've done for us through this week and for the privilege to be here together this morning. And Lord, we pray that you would control the service today and make it exactly what you would desire it to be. You know the needs of our heart. I pray you'd meet those needs this morning as only you can. And if any in this room that does not know Christ as their Savior, I pray, Lord, they'd come to know him before it's eternally too late. So, Lord, work in our hearts today, and may Christ be exalted in our service this morning. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
I want to reign and shine both at the same time, a blessing and a beacon that you'll provide to the fertile fields, the barren plains. Lord, I
turn over to 311, 311, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Let's sing that first together. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, no language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of his presence with me does continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. On that last, I know I shall see in his beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guarded my footstep and given me salt in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am.
Good singing this morning. Now we have a few announcements. Listen carefully if you would. Scheduled tonight, 5:30 for our Christian growth class, and our lesson tonight will be on the church and understanding the importance of the church and what the church is and what it isn't, and that'll be 5:30 tonight. Then 6:30 this evening, we'll be right back here in the auditorium. We'll have the tour group from Hiles Anderson College, an exciting service always when the tour group comes through, especially so for this tour group because we are the last stop. They are done after tonight. And that's always an exciting time for them. And they head back into Hammond tomorrow, and they get to go to the youth conference there Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And so they're pretty pumped and excited to be finished. They've been on the road for 2 months traveling in a different church almost every night. And so I'm sure they're looking forward to this. We're looking forward to it. After the service, got some ice cream sundaes that we're going to have and some hot dogs, I think. And so we'll have a good time of fellowship and food with them and get the volleyball net set up so you, though it's so inclined, can show your volleyball skills if you so prefer to do so. Should be a beautiful night. And looking forward to a great time together this evening. If you like good music, you come back tonight, and we'll have a delightful time together. All right? Then there's Bible school this week, Vacation Bible School. The Great Race will be on, and we're excited about it. The kids have got registered in their Sunday school classes this morning and got the verses to start memorizing, and it's going to be an exciting week. 6:30. Every night, Monday through Thursday, 6:30 each evening. And remember now, Wednesday night will be 6:30 also. So don't come at 7. You'll have missed a half hour. Come on in at 6:30. We'll combine together. When the kids get dismissed around 8 o'clock, then we'll gather together and have a short time of Bible study together as adults. But we want you to be here Wednesday night at 6:30. Okay, so make a note of that. And then this Saturday is a shower for Lisa. And I was just noticing, Brett or Lisa isn't here. Does anybody know anything? Okay. I saw Brett earlier, though, didn't I? Okay, did he go back home then? Okay, I was hoping maybe they were at the you-know-where. But and maybe that's a good sign you're not feeling well, you know? And pray. It could be any time now, any day now for them. So we pray all will be well with that. But they'll have a shower. Maybe after the fact, but we'll have a shower on Saturday, and that's at 1 p.m., shower at 1 p.m. on Saturday. And if you can help with that at all, if you'd like to say, well, if you need any help, I'd be willing to help, see Rachel. Rachel, put your hand up in the air. Rachel Villatoro, right there. If you just see Rachel, she'll be glad to tell you what's needed and what you can do to help her out, okay? All right, well, let's take a moment. And we'll welcome any guests we have with us in the service. We're always pleased when people visit with us in the service. And if you're visiting with us today and you're not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, we'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. And so if you're visiting today, would you honor us by standing just for a moment? We can find out who you are and where you're from. Just stand right. If you brought a guest with you, you can stand. Okay? And these folks look very familiar to me. Go ahead. Great. Good to have you folks. Boy, you look very familiar to me. Are you missionaries? No? No, sir? Well, you are, but you're just not on the, you're serving. Amen. Amen. It's good to have you. Thanks for stopping in and being in church today. That's great. Whereabouts in West Virginia do you go?
Martinsburg.
Okay. And what church? Okay. All right. Good. All right. Great. That's wonderful. Thanks for being in church today. Back here, Lindy. Desiree's friend, and she won't stand and introduce him. What type of girl are you? All right. Charles. Charles was here Wednesday night, and I missed introducing him to you. But good to see you this morning, Charles. Thanks for coming back. Glad you're here this morning. And James is down here, too. James right behind Quentin. Put your hand up, James. James said he came here when he was 15 years old or so. And about 9 years ago, and he come back to check things out. So it's good to see him this morning. Thank you, James. Appreciate you being here. Anybody else this morning? First time, we could give you a card. Okay, if you'll take just a moment and fill out the visitor card for us, we appreciate you doing that. And a little bit, we have the offering. And if you'll just put that card in the offering plate, when we take the offering, we'll have a record of your visit with us. And keep the pen as our gift to you for coming today. Let's give them all a warm welcome, shall we?
57 in your hymnal, 5-7 years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified at Calvary. 57. Let's sing that first together. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died. Grace was free, pardon there was multiplied too. Let's sing that third. Now I've given to Jesus everything. Now I gladly own him as my king. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. As we sing this last together, let's have the children go out to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church as we sing this last. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gold that God did spend at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty. Amen. Great singing this morning. Let's go over to number 90. 90, more love to thee, O Christ, more love to thee. Would you all stand with me as we sing number 90 together? On that first, more love to thee, O Christ, more love to thee. And greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. Pianists will play a few more stanzas, and we'll come back and sing that last together. Thank you. road to its work send grief and pain. Sweet are thy messengers, sweet their refrain. When they can sing with me more love, O Christ, to thee, more love to thee, more love to thee. Let's sing that last all together. Did you find your seats? Then shall my latest breath whisper thy praise. On that last together. Then shall my latest breath whisper thy praise. This be the parting cry my heart shall raise. This still its prayer shall be, more love, O Christ, to thee, more love to thee, more love to thee.
All right, good singing. You may be seated. Ushers will come and we'll get our offering this morning. If you've filled out your welcome card, we'd like you to drop that in the plate as it goes by, if you would. And again, we thank you for being here in our service this morning. And we'll be prepared to give as the Lord has blessed and prospered us. So let's pray for our offering this morning. And I'll have Brother Abrams lead us in our prayer, if you would, please.
Lord, our Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of undeserved kindness this morning, and we ask that you bless this offering. You bless the pastor as he brings the message. Bless our church, bless our country, Lord, as we go forth in your spirit, as we wait for you. We know that we're only visitors here, that we're only passing through. Lord, we thank you this morning for an opportunity to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take your Bible this morning for our scripture reading, if you would, please, to the book of Judges, chapter 3. Judges, chapter 3, please, for our scripture reading. Judges 3, we're going to read verses 7 through 11. Judges 3 and verses 7 through 11. Read the verses responsibly as we normally do. Begin together on 7 and I'll read 8 and alternating verses till we end together on verse 11. And as our custom is, let's stand together for the reading of the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 7 of Judges chapter 3. Ready? And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and forgot the Lord their God, and served Balaam and the groves. Therefore the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he sold them into the hand of Shushan Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia. And the children of Israel served Shushan Rishathaim 8 years. And when the children of Israel cried unto the Lord raised up a deliverer to the children of Israel, who delivered them, even Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he judged Israel, and went out to war. And the Lord delivered Shushan Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia, into his hand. And his hand prevailed against Shushan Rishathaim. And the land had rest 40 years, and Othniel, the son of Kenaz, died. Now, Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the Bible. Thank you, Lord, that we hold copies of it in our hand this morning. And, Lord, I pray that you would continue to make our hearts ready to receive the truth from your word today. Lord, we want our hearts to be good soil, that the word of God will fall into and bring forth fruit in our lives. And so, Lord, we listen today, and we listen not just to be hearers, but we listen in order to be doers. And so, Lord, I pray that you would make us ready to hear your word, blessed especial to that end. In Jesus' name, amen.
Examine that old rugged cross, the mighty gulf it span. It reaches down to the brinks of hell, to heaven's golden strand.
Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer as we come to the preaching of your word. Lord, I thank you for the good music today and for the lifting up of Jesus Christ. Lord, we desire that he be seen this morning. And even as we go into the Old Testament and we look at the man who you raised up to be the first judge in Israel, I pray, Lord, that we would see your hand at work in his life and how you desire to work in our lives as well. And so, Lord, please help the truth of the message to come across this morning. And Lord, I pray that every one of us would give our careful attention to the only book you've ever written. So, Lord, speak to our hearts as only you can do. May your will be done in every heart and life. And we'll thank you for it. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Not too many weeks ago, Muhammad Ali died. I was just a young teenager when he was on the scene boxing, and really a teenager when he was in the latter part of his career, probably. But a great boxer. I don't know all about the earlier things in his life. I know he converted to Muslim, I guess, and became Muhammad Ali from Cassius Clay. But he was a very good boxer. He was a good self-promoter. If any of you are familiar with him at all. He liked to use a lot of clever poetry. The most famous being, "I float like a butterfly, I sting like a bee." That came from his fight with Sonny Liston. He said, "I float like a butterfly, I sting like a bee. Liston's hands can't hit what his eyes cannot see." That's what it came from. He also used that poetry to challenge college students. One time he gave this speech at a college. He said, "Stay in college, get the knowledge, stay there till you're through. If they can make penicillin out of moldy bread, they can sure make something out of you." I don't know about college making something out of you or not, but I'm going to tell you about a man this morning that God made something out of. And God, I like when God makes something out of nothing. And God certainly does that. Doesn't seem like much. In fact, when we mention his name and when we read his name, if I actually had to be honest and take a poll, most of you would not have heard his name mentioned before. Not a one we're familiar with. It doesn't seem like much. In fact, if you pressed to ask what he did or what he accomplished, then you'd be even more puzzled and more baffled to say, "I don't know what he did." But he was very important to God, important enough that God put his name in the book, and God used him to be the first judge in Israel. His name is Othniel. Othniel. Othniel means Lion of God. Lion of God. And he saved Israel from their sin. Now, let me give you a little background on Othniel. All right, Othniel was the nephew of someone named Caleb. You've probably heard of him. He had a good friend named Joshua, and you're probably familiar with Joshua. And so Caleb, if you remember, was, by the way, a very impressive man, and a man who was, the Bible says, wholeheartedly for God, wholeheartedly followed the Lord. And when he was, by the way, Caleb would have been there in Egypt, when God delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt with the plagues and finally with the death of the firstborn and the Exodus out, Caleb would have been there at the Red Sea when God parted the waters and all the Israelites went through on dry ground, and then God drowned all the Egyptian army in the Red Sea. Caleb would have been there to witness that. He was there when the people were around Mount Sinai, and God came down on the mountain and burnt that mountain with fire, and there was thunder and lightning and the sound of the trumpet of God. And then he was there when they got to the very border of the promised land and a place called Kadesh Barnea. And that's when they sent the 12 spies in to spy out the land. And you remember, they came back and they all agreed on one thing. It was a fruitful land. It was a land that flowed with milk and honey. And I mean, the fruit was incredible. It was just an amazing, amazing place as God had described it. But There were 10 of the 12 who saw some obstacles. They saw giants there. Oh, there were cities there that they knew they could occupy and wouldn't have to build. There were vineyards there that they'd be able to tend and wouldn't have to plant. Wells they would not have to dig. And they could see the benefits. But only two men could see that God could give us all this. And 10 of them thought, all I see are giants. All I see are the obstacles. And so they saw the same things, but they focused on different things. And the 10 brought the evil report, and the Bible says that report spread through the camp. And everybody got afraid. They all decided that we can't go in. We can't go forward from here. So they refused to obey God and enter the promised land. And so God said, okay, you made your choice. And he said, what you're going to do is you're going to march around in this wilderness until all of you who are 20 years old and upward die. You won't go into the promised land ever. And so they sat on that 40-year journey throughout the wilderness, literally going in circles, until every one of those men, 20 and upward, would die except for two men. And those two men were Joshua and Caleb. Now, I can't hardly imagine that. Traveling around, and every day somebody's dying. Several somebodies are dying. Can you imagine when you're getting down to the last five? Do you think people were marking down? Oh, there's five, there's four, there's three. Imagine being the last guy. You wake up and say, how you feeling today? Huh? Hoping it'll be the last guy, it'll be over, and we'll be able to move forward from here. Two men, Joshua and Caleb. Joshua, by the way, 40 years later, Joshua, now 85, gets to go into the promised land. And look over in the book look backward to your left to the book of Joshua, would you please? This is recorded for us in Joshua chapter 14. Would you look there? Notice verse number 7. Here's Caleb speaking. 40 years old was I when Moses, a servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land. And I brought him word again as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. And Moses sware on that day, saying, surely the land whereon thy feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance, and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. By the way, Mom and Dad, when you wholly follow the Lord your God, it doesn't just affect you. It'll affect your children and their children. Understand that. Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land whereon thy feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance, thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. And now, behold, the Lord hath kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, lo, I am this day 85 years old. And yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so is my strength now, for war both to go out and to come in. Now therefore give me this mountain, whereof the Lord spake in that day. For thou heardest in the day how the Anakims were there, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be the Lord will be with me, then I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said. And Joshua blessed him and gave unto Caleb the son of Jephunneh Hebron for an inheritance. Hebron therefore became the inheritance of Caleb the son of Jephunneh the Kenizzite unto this day, because he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. And Caleb took the land even at 85 years of age. He, amazing, amazing man, Caleb. We hear a lot about Joshua. We probably don't hear as much, obviously, about Caleb. 85 years of age, and he cleared the giants out of the land. Amazing story. But Othniel was his nephew. So what's so special about Othniel? Look back again at Judges 3. The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and forgot the Lord their God and served Balaam and the groves. And of course they came under a wicked king, and God raised up somebody. He raised up Othniel, the son of Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, in verse number 9, and to deliver them. Listen, throughout the book of Judges, you have the same thing that happens over and over again. The people of Israel sin, and then God punishes them, usually by putting them under bondage to someone else. He allows another nation to come in and overtake them, and they become in bondage or slaves to them. The people get burdened, they see they're wrong, they repent, they cry out to God for deliverance. God raises up a deliverer called a judge, and he delivers them. And then they experience some freedom, they experience deliverance, and then they go back into sin, and then they go back into bondage, and then they cry out to God, and God sends up a deliverer, and it just repeats itself over and over throughout the book of Judges. And what's interesting here, and what we want to notice, is Othniel is the very first judge that Israel ever had, the very first judge that God ever raised up. God chose him to deliver Israel. Now, why choose Othniel? Okay, I'll give you three simple reasons why I believe God chose Othniel to be the first judge in Israel, and why God used him in such a great way. Number one, Othniel, I believe he was a man that was infected. Infected. Say, what in the world does that mean? I think he was infected with faith. I think he was infected with faith. And I think he caught that faith from somebody else. I think the one he caught that from was his uncle named Caleb. I think Caleb was a tremendous influence in his life. I think he observed how Caleb was bold. I think he observed how Caleb wholly followed the Lord his God. And somewhere along the line, Othniel said, that's what I'm going to be like. That's how I'm going to live. Caleb's faith wasn't in Caleb. Caleb's faith was in God. He didn't wholeheartedly believe in himself. He wholeheartedly believed in God. He wholeheartedly had faith in the Lord. And David wrote in Psalm 18, verse 2, that the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. God is my rock in whom I take refuge. He's my shield. He's my horn of salvation. He is my refuge. That's the kind of person Caleb was. And that's the kind of man that God's still looking for. God's looking for men and women of faith. Men and women who will be strong in faith in him. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. The just shall walk and live by faith. Every one of us are to please God and to walk with God and to live for God by faith. He's looking for someone like David. He's looking for someone like Caleb. He's looking for someone like Othniel, who will be a man or a woman of faith. I believe greatly influenced by Caleb. Notice in Judges chapter 1, turn back a page, will you? Something happened in chapter 1. Caleb puts out a plea here. Notice verse number 12, Judges 1 verse 12. Caleb said, he that smiteth Kirjath-Sefer and taketh it, to him will I give Aksa, my daughter, to wife. Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, took it, and he gave him Aksa, his daughter, to wife. And it came to pass, when she came to him, that she moved him to ask her father a field, and she lighted from off her ass. And Caleb said unto her, what wilt thou? And she said unto him, give me a blessing, for thou hast given me a south land. Give me also springs of water. And Caleb gave her the upper springs and the nether springs. Here's Caleb. He says, all right. Now, I don't know. I'm not sure what the circumstances were. It doesn't say anything about Aksa. I don't know what that name means for sure. I don't know whether she had a hard time getting married off, so he kind of put a plea out there. Whoever takes this city gets her for a prize. I don't know. But maybe not. Maybe she was good, and there was many men interested in her. I don't know. But I tell you what, Othniel said, I'll take that challenge on. And he went after a whole city. Boy, the things men will do for love, huh? And I went after a whole city and captured it so he could have her to wife. But I like that. You know what's interesting about a man of faith? Listen, no words are ever listed that Othniel spoke. because he wasn't a man of words, he was a man of action. I like a man that doesn't talk about his faith. I like a man who lives his faith. God says, I'm looking for Christians who will walk a better Christian life than they talk a Christian life. Most of the time, most of us talk a better Christian life than we walk. And God says, I'm looking for people who will walk a Christian life, where their words will be few. God's in heaven, thou art on earth, therefore let thy words be few. And he says, let's live the way we ought to live. And so Caleb throws down the challenge for somebody to take the city, and Othniel just gets up and takes the city. Now, I think he got some of that courage and he learned some of that, because that sounds like something Caleb would do. In fact, at 85, that is what he did. And he said, oh, here's, you're going to take this. He said, it's all right. I'm just as strong now as I was 45 years ago. I got news for you. I'm not as strong now as I was 10 years ago. It just doesn't work that way. Sin takes its toll on the body. Amen. And I know, you know, the mind, in the, I'm still a legend in my own mind, but that's all the further it goes. And the body doesn't cooperate. And so I think Othniel thought, if Caleb can do that, I can do that too. In fact, the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. So we have that same promise as Christians that Caleb and Othniel had back in their day. The same God who was there for them is there for us. Hey, the same God who backed up David when he went against Goliath, that's the same God that is there for you and me. The same God that backed up Caleb when he went in to fight those giants at 85 years of age is the same God that backs up you and me. I can do all things through Christ. I think Othniel became a man of faith because he hung around a man of faith. You become like the people you hang around. And by the way, let me say, that's what church is about. That's part of what church is all about. You know what you do? You get to hang around with some other men and women of faith. You know what that does? That rubs off on you. That affects you. I've heard people say, you've heard them say, well, I can be just good a Christian and not go to church. Can I tell you, can I be kind enough to you to tell you that's a lie? You can be a Christian and not go to church. You won't be a good Christian and not go to church. Okay? You won't be a good Christian and forsake the assembling of yourselves together. Because God says we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, but we're to be gathering together and we're to be exhorting one another. What's that? Encouraging one another. And so much the more as we see the day approaching. It means we should not be looking to get to church less. We should be looking to get to church more as the day's approaching. We should be wanting to get together more with the people of God. And that helps us. That encourages us. That exhorts us. We come to church and it's a place where we rub off on each other. It's a place where we strengthen each other. It's a place where you get challenged to do great things for God. You get challenged to live for the Lord. This gathering together on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night or Sunday school classes, that's not just an end in itself. That's not just so you can get attendance pins that can drag on the ground from your chest. That's not the purpose of it all. There's a purpose of being strengthened. There's a purpose of getting your faith, growing in your faith. You're going to get stronger as you grow together. Remember, it was one of the old preachers, I think Spurgeon used the illustration, I'm not sure if it was him or not, who had a church member that had missed several weeks of church. And he went by to see the man on a winter's day and knocked on his door, and the man opened the door and told him to come in. He had two chairs sitting in front of his fireplace, and the men sat down, each in the chair, looked at the fire. Neither one said a word. And the story goes, he said, Spurgeon got up and went over to the fireplace and reached with the tongs and took a coal from that fire and set it out on the hearth. Closed the grate, put the tongs back up, sat back down in his chair. And that coal that was red and glowing soon began to grow dimmer and darker and then gray as the men sat there and never said a word. They both looked at that coal die out. And the man looked over at the pastor and he said, I'll be back in church on Sunday. So what's the point? You remove yourself from all the other coals, and pretty soon you will grow gray and cold by yourself. You need God's people. You need the people of God. And it reignites the fire within you and reignites the passion within you, and it'll keep you on fire for God. There's iron sharpens iron, the Bible says. And that takes place when you come to church. And you miss that when you miss church. So, and I saw a sign the other day that said, when you miss, the more you miss church, the less you miss church. You ever think about that? The more you miss church, the less you miss church. You get in the habit. That's why it's such a blessing. There's a family just traveling and they end up in church. You know why? They don't want to get used to missing church. Because you get used to missing church, you won't miss church so much. Things take their things. You give the devil an inch, he'll take a mile. Boy, just stay in the routine. You go away on vacation, you go away and you take time off. Don't take time off from God. Don't take time off from church. Keep yourself in the house of God. So I think Othniel was chosen to save Israel because he was infected with faith. And he got that, I think, from his uncle. Number two, I think Othniel was chosen because he'd been prepared beforehand. He had been prepared for the job. He had an active faith that God that when God chose him to do what he wanted to do. And by the way, God always chooses people that are busy doing something. Othniel wasn't just sitting around staring at the sky. He wasn't sitting around playing video games. He was doing something for God. He was active in his faith when first of all, he heard the challenge from Caleb to go take this city, and so he said, okay, I'll do that. And he took the city. You know, some of the great heroes in the Bible, do you ever think about this? Abraham and Joseph and David and others. Many of them are known for just one thing, or we associate with just one thing. Listen, Noah and the ark. He built the ark. I always associate those two together. He built an ark and it floated on the water for a while. Say, well, it was a big deal. No, that's a big deal. That's a real big deal. Gideon. Gideon defeated the Midianites with how many? 300 men. That's what you remember Gideon for. What about Esther? Esther, God raised her up to deliver his people from the Persians, the evil king, and she said, I'm going to go in and talk to the king, and if I perish, I perish. But I'm going to do my best to save my people. What about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the three Hebrew boys? What do you know them for? They didn't bow down. They went into the fiery furnace. Jesus appears there with them to deliver them. That's what you know about them. Of course, then you go to the New Testament, and there's Andrew. How many know who Andrew was? He had a famous brother. Who was Andrew's brother? Peter. How did Peter come to Jesus? Andrew got him. Three times Andrew's mentioned by name. And you know what? One time he brought his brother to Christ. The next time you read about Andrew, he brought the little boy with the lunch to Christ. And they fed 5,000 men besides the women and children. Third time you read about Andrew is some Greeks came to the feast and they said, we would see Jesus, and Philip brought him to Andrew. You know what Andrew did? Andrew brought him to Jesus. Only three times you read about Andrew, and he brought somebody to Jesus every time. That's what Andrew did. Just brought people to Jesus. Another interesting fellow is Ananias. Not the one married to Sapphira. Ananias, the guy who Saul, when Saul got saved on the road to Damascus, remember, God told him, you're going to go into a street called Straight to a house of a man named Ananias. And then God had to talk to Ananias. He said, hey, Saul has gotten saved and he's going to come to your house. Remember Ananias? Ananias said, remember, we read that not too long ago. He said, Lord, you know this guy has done a lot of bad things. Like God said, is that right? Wow. And he was, Did you know that's the only time Ananias is mentioned? That was it. He called him Brother Saul. He stayed there. After 3 days, he baptized him. And that's all that's ever recorded about him. That was his moment to shine. And he shined for God. That was it. That was all we ever read of him. And here they are. Listen, men who God prepared and God made ready, and for the one event that God had for them, they did it. And it impacted history. Amazing thing when you look at the big picture of how that all came together. God didn't just pluck them out of the air, my friend. He'd been training them for that job all of their life. A professor of sociology at the University of Connecticut wrote a book called Rescuers, Portraits of Holocaust Survivors. He interviewed people who had harbored fugitive Jews in their homes during the Holocaust, despite danger to them and their families, obviously. But what he found out was very interesting. What he found out was that the rescuers had a history of doing good deeds before the war ever started. They visited people in the hospital. They collected books for poor students. Others had taken in stray animals. They were in the habit of doing good. They were in the habit of helping others. And so they got it. What was that? That was God preparing them. It would just be the natural thing for them to do, to say, let me help you. Let me do something for you. They weren't, the other people might have been paralyzed to do something. They were prepared to do that. And they easily did that. That's what God's looking for. Listen to me. God's looking for people who've been faithful to Him and who will just be faithful to Him. You know, God said it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. You know, if God's going to require us something or require something of us, then it has to be within our grasp. It has to be something that we'll be able to do. And every single believer can be faithful. If I have to sit down and say amen and preach both, it'll be a long sermon. God says every one of us can be faithful. You want to go home, don't you? Huh? Now we give, don't give amen to that with your mouth. Give amen to that with your life. I saw a post not too long ago that said if going to church were your job, how many of you would have a job? Try going one out every 3 days to your job and see how that works. Well, I come every Sunday. What's wrong with Sunday night? What's wrong with Wednesday night? One out of three, you won't keep your job. But we want to go one out of three and say, what a good Christian am I? It's not faithful. I don't get the newspaper at home anymore. I'm not sure hardly anybody does, but if the fellow delivered my newspaper one out every 3 days, I'd be getting me a new newspaper carrier. I would not allow that. If my car went out and I started it one out every 3 days, I would say, son, I got to get a different car. Not dependable. Then we say, God, use me. God, do something with my life. And God says, I would if you were dependable. Can't count on you. The faithful man shall abound with blessing. Faithfulness. You may not be able to have the talent to play a piano. You may not have the talent to get up and sing a special. You may not have the talent to get up and teach a group of people. But you know what you can do? You can be faithful. Every believer can be faithful. And if you can be faithful, God says you'll abound with blessings. And that's who God looks for. When he wants to raise somebody up to be a deliverer, when he wants to raise somebody up to do a work for him, he looks for faithfulness. That's where he's looking. because God prepares us. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth, the Bible says, to show Himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are perfect towards Him. God's looking for people of faith and faithfulness. Then He can use them to do great things. I think that's why God chose Othniel. And then let me share this with you in closing. Third reason I think He used Othniel. Because God set him up. God set him up. Let me explain that to you. I think God just put him at the right place at the right time to do the right thing. Because I think He wanted to show us something. Listen carefully. Othniel is of the tribe of Judah. Do anybody remember what we said Othniel's name means? Lion of God. Lion of God from the tribe of Judah, chosen to be the rescuer of Israel. Does that sound like anybody else? Yeah, sounds a whole lot like Jesus Christ, doesn't it? He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah, chosen to be the rescuer. He rescues God's people from their sins. That was Othniel. Jesus was born in the tribe of Judah. Revelation 5 calls Him the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He was sent to rescue us, to save us from our sins. Thou shalt call His name Jesus, for He shall save His people from their sins. But there's another little nugget here that God threw into us. And that's the name. I'm sure you caught it as I tried to read it. Verse number 8. When God sold them into the hand of Shushan-Rish-Athaim. Shushan-Rish-Athaim. Boy, that's a name, isn't it? Besides being especially hard to pronounce, okay? It has a meaning. That word, Shushan-Rish-Athaim, means doubly wicked blackness. Doubly wicked blackness. Does that sound like anybody we know? That sounds like old Smutty Face himself. That's the wicked one. That's Satan. So the Lion of God came, God raised Him up to defeat the doubly wicked blackness so we could be free from the curse of our sin. Isn't God amazing? And there it is, tucked in Judges 3. With Othniel. To let Israel know. I'm raising up a lion out of the tribe of Judah who's going to be the Savior. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14 says, For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, He also Himself likewise took part of the same. That's Jesus. That He through death might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. That's Jesus. And He came and He took on flesh and He lived a perfect sinless life. And listen, my friend, and yet He went to the cross and He died on the cross as a payment for our sin. Jesus Christ never committed a sin. He would not have to pay the wages of sin, which is death. But He died on the cross. The Bible says He died for us. He died in our place. What happened that day on the cross is He took every sin that I've ever committed, and even sins I haven't committed yet, but He knows I will, and He laid those sins on Himself. And He said, God punish me instead of staying Slabaugh. And He took all your sin and put them on Himself. He said, God punish me instead of put your name there. You see, the songwriter wrote, I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. I should have hung on the cross in disgrace. But Jesus, God's Son, took my place. He took your place this morning, my friend. And listen, you must receive Him as your Savior. You must believe He died for you. He was buried. He rose again the third day. And if you'll call upon Him, He'll forgive you of your sin. He'll give you the gift of eternal life. And you shall be saved. You have to belong to Him to be used by Him. Othniel, a simple man willing to trust God, willing to serve God, willing to be used by God. You know what the point is? God's still looking for people like that. Oh, you know, I'll never be a David. I'll never be an Abraham. I'll never be a Moses. No, but you could be an Othniel. You just somebody, God, I'll believe you. God, I'll trust you. God, use me. Just let me be used by God. And when you trust God and you're willing to serve God and you're willing to let Him be in charge of your life, God will do something great with your life. You'll influence some people with your life and you won't even be aware. I'm not sure. I'm sure He's aware now. Othniel was aware now he's in here. I don't think he was aware when he was alive. All it is, in fact, be honest. Before we spoke about him this morning, how many of you probably, if you were pressed to tell me something about Othniel, you wouldn't know what to say? Huh? Yeah? See, we didn't know much about him, but God knew about him. My friend, it does not matter who else knows about you. What matters is that God knows about you. That's all that matters. Let God use your life. Be an Othniel. But to be an Othniel, you have to belong to Him. You have to belong to Him. If you've never received Christ as your Savior, you need to receive Him today. Let's bow for prayer, shall we? Father, we pray you'll take the truth this morning. Thank you, Lord, for this first judge that you raised up in Israel, Othniel. And thank you, Lord, for his faith. Thank you for his faithfulness. Thank you for his preparation, Lord. And Father, thank you, Lord, that you set him up. You showed us a picture that he's the Lion of God and that he's from the tribe of Judah. You raised up that first judge to be the deliverer, and you've raised up another lion out of the tribe of Judah, Jesus Christ, to deliver us from our sins. And Lord, my prayer is twofold this morning. I pray that if anyone in this room has never called on Jesus Christ and asked him to be their Savior, that they would trust him as their Savior this morning. And Lord, my second prayer would be those who have trusted him as their Savior and they belong to you by faith in Christ, that they would say, I'll be an Othniel. I want to live by faith. I'm willing to trust God. I'm willing to be used by God. I just want to serve God. I'll have faith and I'll be faithful and ask God to do something great with my life. Lord, I pray you'll minister to hearts this morning. And I trust you have. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'll finish this prayer in just a moment. But right now, just between you and God, nobody looking, I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, if I died this morning, I know 100% sure that I'd go to heaven. There's a time in my life when I knew I was a sinner, I knew I needed to be saved, and I knew Jesus was the Savior I needed. And Pastor, I called on the Lord Jesus. I believed from my heart, and I asked Him to be my Savior. I know that I'm saved here this morning, Pastor. Here's my hand as a testimony. Would you lift it up for a moment and say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. Who's here this morning would say, Pastor, I can't raise my hand on that. I don't know for sure that if I died, I'd go to heaven. My friend, could I pray for you today? I'll not embarrass you or not call you out, but I will pray for you. Would you slip your hand up and say, Pastor, pray for me right now? God bless you. Thank you. Are there others this morning will join this? Say, Pastor, pray for me. Just slip it up and put it back down. I'll see it. You couldn't raise your hand the first time, but you raise it this time. Would you do it? God bless you. I see it. Thank you. I wonder how many Christians here today would say, Preacher, God spoke to my heart today. I believe I can be an Othniel. I want to live by faith. I want to just believe God and trust God. I want to be faithful to God. I know God will prepare me, and I just want to be in that place where God can use me to do what He wants for His glory. Pastor, God dealt with my heart this morning. Here's my hand. Will you slip it up, Christian? Amen. 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 You may put it down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. Listen carefully. If you slipped your hand up, and even if you didn't, then but you're not sure of your salvation. You don't know that if you died, you go to heaven. In a moment when I pray, we'll stand to our feet. The pianist will begin to play. Bob will sing. Folks will be coming. Christians will be coming to kneel at the altar and to pray and talk to God. Just slip out from your seat while they're coming forward. You come with them, would you? I'll meet you right here at the front. We have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible, and they'll show you how you can know for sure that when you die, you'll go to heaven. If you're here today and you're saved and you've ever been scripturally baptized, you ought to say, I need to be baptized. And Christian, if God has spoken to your heart, I want you to come. Kneel at the altar. Bow your knee to the Lord this morning and surrender yourself to being Othniel. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to hearts this morning. Thank you, Lord, for decisions that have been made. People responding to your still small voice speaking to them. And now, Lord, I pray that those who need to come and receive Christ as their Savior, that they'll come. They'll let someone take a Bible and show them from the Bible how you can give us a guarantee of heaven. Others will come and just bow the knee and ask you to use them and ask you to help them be faithful so they can be usable to you. Hear their prayer this morning, God. May your will be done in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, I want you to stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. I want you to respond to him this morning, and you come.
You have longed
That's right.
for sweet peace and for faith to increase. And have earnestly, fervently prayed. But you cannot have rest or be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart, does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul.
Still time for you to come this morning.
Would you walk with the Lord?
Oh, don't leave lost today, would you?
In the light of his word.
Don't leave without doing what God has asked you to do.
Must do his sweet will to be free from all ill. On the altar, your all you must lay. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart, does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul.
Christians, I want you to be praying right now. If you're here today and you've never received Christ, you may have another opportunity. But I know this, you'll never have a better opportunity than you have right now. Folks in this room are praying for you, and we're asking God to touch your heart. Why don't you slip out and come? If you're near somebody and maybe a word of encouragement would help them, maybe you just slip to them and say, you know, if you'd like to go, I'll go with you. I'll go with you. Hate to think I slip into a church service and I'm lost and no one ever said anything to me. I'd want someone to know that I care about it. Sing that chorus together, all right?
Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart, does the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and soul.
Appreciate your attention this morning. We have a young man that came forward, and we're going to be dealing with him. So we'll pray that the Lord will open his heart, and he'll receive Christ as Savior. So be praying for him this morning. All right? Let's bow together, shall we? Father, thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, for meeting with us. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts today. We thank you so much for the Bible, for your word to us, for the Holy Spirit who still speaks to us through your word. And Lord, thank you for decisions that have been made this morning for you. I pray for this young man this morning that you'll open his understanding, that he'll receive Christ as his Savior. Lord, others this morning that you're dealing with, and Lord, I pray that if they're leaving this building without Christ, that you will continue to deal with their heart, and Lord, until they bow their knee and they trust you as their Savior. Lord, we love you. We thank you for a wonderful time together this morning. Pray you'll give us a good afternoon. Bring us back safely for our services this evening. Be with the singing group as they travel to get here this afternoon. Please watch over them and give them safety. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, we're going to sing. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Remember, if you can help with Lisa's shower, you see Rachel Villatora, will you? And she could use a little help on that for Saturday. All right, Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.